Good morning. We have met together this morning to praise the Lord, to worship Him. So as we begin, I want to read Psalm 150. Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty expanse. Praise Him for His mighty deeds. Praise Him according to His excellent greatness. Praise Him with trumpet sound. Praise Him with harp and lyre. Praise Him with timbrel and dancing. Praise Him with stringed instruments and pipe. Praise Him with loud cymbals. Praise Him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Father, this morning as we have come to praise You, we know that the very breath in our lungs is from You, everything we have. So as we return to You what You have given to us, we ask that You be pleased, that You indwell us with Your Holy Spirit, that we might truly worship in spirit and truth, because we know, as we have been told in Your word, that is what You desire, worshipers that will worship You in spirit and truth. So thank You, Father. Bless this time together. Amen.
Water You turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like You. None like You. Into the darkness You shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no
awesome in power, our God.
coming on the clouds. Kings and kingdoms will bow down. Every chain will break as broken hearts declare His praise. Oh, who can stop the Lord Almighty?
Love.
your trumpet sound. Oh, may heaven in him be found. Trust in his righteousness alone. Faultless stand before the throne. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I wanna see you. I want to see you. See you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. It may be formed, but it won't prosper. when the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail.
Suffering anguish,
despised and rejected, bearing our sin. My Redeemer is He, the hands that heal nations, stretched down on a tree. He took the nails for me, living He loved me, dying He saved me, buried He carried our sins far away, rising He justified. Cannot hold Him, the grave cannot keep Him from rising again. Living He loved me, dying He saved me, buried He carried our sins far away, rising He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day. Glorious day, glorious day. One day the trumpet will sound for His coming. One day the skies of His glories will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved one is bringing. My Savior Jesus is mine, living He loved me, dying He saved me, buried He carried my sins far away, rising He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious.
Any birthdays?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. God bless you. Happy birthday.
Thank you, Ian, and Ben, and Bob. For those that are maybe here today for the first time, we are with about half of our worship team. As you may or may not know, Pastor Scott will be retiring soon and moving to South Carolina. His daughter Beth and her husband Jeff and their family are already there. Pastor Scott is down there now helping them get moved in, and they'll be staying together after Pastor and Robin sell their house in Pulaski. They'll be living there in Hartsville, I believe it is, Hartsville, South Carolina. So that's why Pastor is not here today. He will be back before he's gone to move, but just today they're down there helping Beth and Jeff get settled in and a little bit of their own. So that's why you don't see maybe people you normally see here today. And with them, we're losing Beth on the keyboard in the worship team, but We still have Ian, who's doing a terrific job. So we have a father and son team with Ben and Ian, and then Bob Denny, we thank for being here on the bass. And right now, Ben's wife, Autumn, is taking their son, Evan, to a commercial diving school in Hudson, Florida. The school is, a few days away from starting, I think, maybe next week or something like that. So they're kind of hanging out right now with some relatives in Florida. But Autumn does sing on the worship team, and she'll be back, hopefully, in a couple weeks. So that's why things maybe look a little different this morning. Okay, at this time, we'll pray over the offering, and then you can bring forward. Again, we, instead of passing plates, we make sure that offering is a voluntary thing. So if you have an offering, you can bring it to the basket. If not, that's fine too. The Lord knows each of our circumstances. Let's pray. Dear Father, we thank you that you are the source of everything. You are the beginning, the end, the middle. You provide everything that we need, from our very lives, the breath in us, the work that we can do to earn a living, the other things that we need that you have provided. And Lord, we just want to, in praise to you, in acknowledgement, we want to return to you for your kingdom's work, a little bit of what you have given to us, especially what you've given to us through your Son, Jesus Christ, as we have just been singing about. So bless this offering to your kingdom's use, Lord, and bless the people, all of them here today, and those who are watching. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I guess I forgot to say, and you can greet a neighbor on the way back. We got to try to maintain some traditions here, I guess, in Pastor Scott's absence, and he normally says that, so. So this morning we are privileged in Pastor Scott's absence to have Les Green and his wife Linda here with us and some friends. And Les will be bringing the message this morning. We've had Les here before. They've come in several different capacities. Sometimes they put on a full concert with their equipment and all. But today we're just going to hear from God's word. So Brother Les, if you would come on up, we'll hear what the Lord wants to tell us.
Thank you. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? How's that? Is that better? Excellent, excellent. Happy Labor Day weekend. You can always tell the poor people, they're at church on Labor Day weekend. I'm poor, and so, but it's great to be with you and to see. I'll tell you what, it's like looking out at Old Home Day for Linda and I. Linda's right over there, and she's sitting next to some friends of ours that live down by Fulton. Also, they came all the way up from Fulton to be here, and it's always good to see other friends. It's good to see each and every one of you. How many are friends on Facebook with me? Anybody? Some of you. And you saw my video of flying, right? Did you see that? That 1927 Ford tri-motor. That was amazing. It really was. And brother back there, you flew the next day, didn't you? Yep. It was great. Did they give you a parachute? Anyway, it is good to be with you in Pastor Scott's absence. I love looking out. Normally we sing from down there, but I love looking out and seeing him back there. And I love that guy. I love he and his wife and their family. I really do. But this is At least he's not scraping bark off on some Midwest road. You don't get it. Okay, that's good. Maybe that's a good thing. But we're glad that he's enjoying his time down there. But it is Labor Day weekend. I'll give you some Labor Day facts. Here we go. It's a federal holiday. It's always the first Monday in September. This year it's September 5th. And it honors America. A lot of people think it's a military weekend. It's not. It honors American workers and laborers and their contribution and to the achievements of the United States. And let's see, started with a parade in 1882 in New York City. Did you know that? It did. It became a national holiday in 1894. Anybody know who was president in 1894? Anybody? Now, Sonny, I thought you'd remember this because that was back in your time. Grover Cleveland. Grover Cleveland was the president. Let's see. Celebrations in our day, they're usually with parades and barbecues. Anybody having a barbecue today? Anybody? All right. No barbecues today. And the last thing is that it's the unofficial end of hot dog season. And let me toss this in. And it's the unofficial end of wearing white.
Yes, absolutely.
And do you know why that is? Because it's the end of vacation time and you should only wear white during never. That was the B side. Remember, those of you, remember vinyl records? Remember that? Remember vinyl records? Remember the B side? The A side was the primo side, the premium side. That was the B side. Right here is the A side. You know what this is? This is a message from God this morning. Are you ready for that? Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your precious word. Thank you for this church. And I pray that you'll impart some not just wisdom, but knowledge to us, something that we can take with us when we leave this building, and it will make us better for the kingdom of God, will make us profitable for other people that hear about Jesus. We ask that you'll do that for us today in his precious name. Amen. All right, if you will take your Bibles or electronic devices, whatever you got, right, and turn to the book of James chapter 2. And while you're turning to that, let me flesh this out a little bit. I'll give you a little bit of background information. James, it's actually a letter. It's not a book, it's a letter. And it was written by the younger brother of Jesus. Right? He didn't believe that Jesus was who he was claiming to be until after the resurrection of Christ. Then he was all in. In fact, he was so all in, so invested, that he would become a martyr. He would die for his faith up around the year 60-62 AD. And so he was involved in this big time. And he wrote this letter to a group of Christians who had been scattered because of persecution, and they had gone out to the outer reaches, to the borders of Palestine, right? And so he's writing this letter to them, and it's a letter that gives us kind of a vision of what it could look like if we really, really live out our faith. So chapter one, it talks about how faith changes the way we respond when life kind of blows up. Right? It like when your computer goes down and your rent goes up. Or when your car breaks down. Or when things are going wrong in your family domestically. It gives us an idea of how faith affects that. And in the second chapter, the beginning part of it, he talks about favoritism and how faith affects the way we look at people and evaluate them. And so today we come to a part of the latter part of chapter 2, that it's the part that A lot of people love the book, the letter of James, because of this chapter. But people like Martin Luther, remember Martin? Again, Sonny, you'll remember Martin Luther, right? Yeah, he was probably went to school with you or something. But I'm sorry to pick on you. But Martin Luther, he was a great reformer, great theologian, and he lived during the 1500s. And he didn't like this letter of James because of this chapter that we're going to look at today. And so let me get into it. Let me read it. Chapter 2, I'm going to start with verse 14. Here it is. This is what James said about 2,000 years ago. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith, but they don't have any deeds? Can that kind of faith save them? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food, and if one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well-fed, but does nothing to help them, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it's not accompanied by actions, is dead. But someone will always say, you have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I'll show you my faith with my deeds. You believe that there is one God. Great. Even the demons believe that, and they're scared to death. You foolish person, do you want evidence that faith without deeds is useless? Wasn't our father Abraham considered righteous for what he did when he offered his son Isaac on the altar? You see, that his faith and his actions were working together, and his faith was made complete by what he did. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness, and he was called God's friend. Verse 24, you see that a person is considered righteous by what they do, and not by faith alone. In the same way, was not even Rahab the prostitute considered righteous for what she did when she gave lodging to the spies and sent them off in a different direction? As the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without deeds is dead. That's kind of the heart of the letter. That's the focal part of it. But before I go on, let me give you an illustration that I love to give this, I really do, and it's so poignant. And suppose I stand up here, or no, let me go this way. Suppose you're walking with me to my car, and on the way out to my car, I kind of boast a little bit, and I tell you, I'm this fitness fanatic. You're not buying it already, are you? And anyway, as we're walking out, and you look at me, and you can tell I'm not Arnold Schwarzenegger. I'm not some, anyway. But we get to my car, and you know, and I'm telling you, yeah, I'm really into fitness, and I show you my YMCA membership card, and I show you that little key fob that gets me in the building there, 24 hours a day. And we get in my car, and I show you my fitness magazine, and there's a men's health there and all that stuff. I show you my Fitbit, right? That helps me to track my workouts. I show you my jump rope, because jumping rope is a cardiovascular nuclear bullet. It's great, right? But while we're in there, you look and you see all these potato chip bags all over the dash. And you see Doritos bags, and you see that I've thrown in the back, there's like 36 empty cans of Coke, right? You see all that back there. And I said, oh, watch your legs. And by your legs is this industrial-sized bag of peanut M&Ms, right? And then you see something. You see a pack of cigars. You know, there's only 6 left in there because I'm not really, this is just for illustration, because, you know, I probably go through like 12 of these a day. And I'm telling you, I'm this fitness fanatic. Would you buy that? Would you buy that I'm a fitness guy? No, you just wouldn't. Why not? Why wouldn't you? Well, you don't have to answer it. Right, it's contradictory, isn't it? I'm telling you that I'm this fitness guru, but but you don't believe me. And there's a reason you're not going to believe me because of this. And there's one word that's very poignant. And if we want to understand the Christian faith, if we want to understand Jesus, if we want to understand why a lot of people around us, our neighbors, a lot of 21st century Americans don't take the Christian faith seriously, it's because of that one word. That word is integrity. Integrity. It's integrity. The word integrity, it basically means to be undivided, singular, whole. You remember that word from high school math, integer? How many remember that word, integer? The word integer is a whole number. It's not a fraction. It's not a part of a number. It's not divided. And it comes from that same root word as integrity. And that's the reason a moment ago when I'm telling you that I'm this fitness person, you didn't take me seriously about my commitment to health. And that's why a lot of people don't take our faith seriously. They don't. They laugh at us. They see a minister on TV and they're just yucking it up. They're just going crazy all over. It's an issue of integrity, or in this case, a lack of integrity. And that's what James is talking about here in this letter. And now the reason that Martin Luther back in the 1500s didn't like this letter or this book, and the reason a lot of Christians don't like this book, is because it seems to contradict. Listen to this. I'm going to say something here. It seems to contradict what the rest of the Bible or other parts of the Bible say when it talks about salvation. Ooh. What do I mean by salvation? I mean, what does it take for a person to be saved or rescued from being judged for their sin? What does it take to be forgiven and to be made right with a holy God? And on the surface, it seems like James is saying something totally different than what other writers are talking about. Let me give you an example. Over in the book of Ephesians was written by who? Paul. He wrote a lot of the New Testament. And over in the second chapter, verses 8 and 9, he says these words. By grace are you saved through faith. It's not of yourselves. It is a gift of God. And it's not of works, so that no one can boast. Isn't that good news? Isn't that great? You can't do anything, Paul is saying, to get to heaven. You just can't do it. It's not by what we do. Then in another letter he wrote to a group of Christians in a city called Rome, he wrote these words. Listen to this. Therefore, no one will be declared righteous in God's sight by the works of the law. What is the law? The Ten Commandments, right? It's the Ten. Basically, that's basically what it is. Rather, through the law, we become conscious or aware of ours. We become, it's like looking, that's the standard right there. That's holiness. And it relates to God. It relates to other people. By that, we become aware of how unholy we really are. A few verses later, down in verse 28, chapter 3, he says, we maintain that a person is justified, made right with God, made at peace with God. That word reconciled comes in there too. We're justified by faith apart from the works of the law. Pretty clear, right? Is that pretty clear? It's very blatant. And we could look at 10 more verses in the Bible where the whole point is that a person is saved by what? Faith. They're saved by faith, right? Not by obeying the rules. Listen to me now. Don't drift off here because maybe you're not getting something. We're not saved by obeying the rules. And when the Bible uses the word gospel, what does the word gospel mean? Good news. And that's the good news. I'm not good enough, and I never can be good enough to match up with a holy God. But Jesus is. I have goosebumps on my arm right now. Jesus is good enough. And when I put my faith in him, then I'm forgiven. That's the good news. He's good enough, and I'm not. But his righteousness becomes my righteousness, and I become reconciled. At one point, I'm at enmity with God. You know what that word enmity basically? It means that I'm at war with God. But when I'm reconciled to God through faith and grace, I become made at peace with God. I become then, because of Jesus, God's friend, and I become saved. So, imagine this for a moment. I stand up here and I say, I'm a Christian. I know I'm a messed up sinner, but I have put my faith in Jesus and I am saved. But then you go out, I go out, over the next few months, you follow me around. You see me different places. You see that I flirt with other women that aren't my wife. You see me gesticulating. You see me making gestures to people out on the road that are just stupid drivers. You see me doing things. You see me cursing out people. You see me being unkind to that 16-year-old clerk at the store who's up to her eyeballs in monkeys. And she's just so busy, and she's going as fast as she can, but I'm impatient, and I'm loudly chewing her out. You see me spending my weekends drunk. Ooh. You see me, but yet, every Sunday, I stand up here, and I say, I'm a Christian. Is that possible? Don't answer this out loud, because you might be surprised. Is that possible? Is it possible for me? You know, it's not an academic question. It's a relevant question. It means something to us. And it's exactly what the question that James is addressing here in this letter. Now, I'm going to talk about this under two headings this morning. The first one is artificial faith. Fake faith. The second part is real faith, genuine faith. So here we go. First part, fake faith. There are two kinds of fake faith that I'll bring this up. The first one is good intentions. Ooh, good. Listen, verse 15. Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food, and if one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? That's what James is asking, that question. Let me contemporize this a little bit. Say a lady's been coming into church for the past few weeks. She comes in, and she's a single mom, two kids. Her husband, her ex-husband, who is supposed to be paying her $1,000 a month, she hasn't seen that or him in over a year. Her rent has just gone up. She's working, and she's just barely scraping by. Her rent has gone up. Her car is broke down. And you come up to her, and you say, hey, it's good to see you again. How are you doing? And you open that up. And she says, I'm doing okay, but she's up to her eyeballs. And she's full emotionally. And then you see her start to cry, and you say, what's wrong? And that opens it up, and she starts to tell you all the things that are going on in her life. And this is what this person does. Oh, I'm sorry to hear that, but I want you to know that I'm going to be praying for you. I believe that God is going to provide for you. She kind of nods her head and wipes away her tears, and you walk away. James asks the question, What good is that? What good have you done? Hi, sweetie. She's smiling at me. Have your good intentions done anything to help that scared and confused person? You know, Linda and I, as we've traveled for decades. We've been all over the country, and we have seen deep addiction, great addiction. We have seen great homelessness. We've seen little kids sleeping on a winter's day in a door casing. In our heart, we've seen confused people. We've seen depressed people, people who are lonely. And we have felt our hearts have gone out to them. But James is saying here, if I never take any action to help, if I never go beyond my good intentions, this is what he says, I have reason to question the reality of my faith. Here's the second part of artificial faith. I'll call it intellectual agreement. We used to call it years ago head knowledge, not heart knowledge, head knowledge, kind of on the surface, is just there, superficial. Verse 19 says, James, you believe that there is one God. Good. Even the demons believe that, and they shudder. Are you getting this? They shudder. There's a story in the book of Mark where Jesus is teaching in this tabernacle, this temple. And this man comes up who's possessed by a demon. And the demon speaks to Jesus. And he says, I know who you are. You're the Holy One of God. This is my best demon voice. It's the best I got. You're the Holy One of God. Right? There are numerous times. See, this demon believed in Jesus, didn't he? There are numerous accounts in the New Testament where demons speak to Jesus. They always know who he is. Here's the question. Does this mean that these demons had faith? Okay. Get ready. I mean, were they believers in Jesus? Yeah, they were. The Bible says they were so much believers in Jesus that they shuddered. They believed in Jesus. They were scared to death. They knew the power that he had. But here's what James is saying. That's not the kind of faith that saves you. It's not the kind of faith that connects you to the saving power of God. It's not head knowledge. It's not intellectual agreement. So if a person says, you know, I believe these historical facts. I believe that Jesus lived a good life. I believe that he died on a cross for sin. But yet, much like a demon, that life isn't submitted to or obedient to Jesus in any way, then it's fake faith. That's what James is saying. Don't blame me. Again, I'm just the message bearer, right? Don't kill the messenger, right? James says it this way. Look at verse 17. I love expository preaching. You know what that is, right? It's where you expose the scriptures. You take it apart. You just consume it. Verse 17, in the same way, faith by itself, if it's not accompanied by action, here's what he says, it's dead. Down at verse 20, he says, you foolish person, do you want evidence that faith without deeds is useless? So that if it's only good intentions, if it's only head knowledge, then it's useless and it's dead. Useless and dead. Ooh, it's useless on two different levels. First of all, it's useless to you. Verse 14, what good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Listen to this. Can that kind of faith save them? Rhetorical question, right? Right? Rhetorical. That kind of faith will not save a person. And Jesus said the same thing. Isn't that something? Jesus and James preached the same thing. Matthew chapter 7, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only he who does what? The will of my Father who is in heaven. You know, sometimes we freak out when we read verses like that. We really do. It looks like Jesus is saying that you can earn your way to heaven. Apparently, Jesus doesn't understand the gospel. Jesus understands the gospel. He does. He understands. And he taught the same thing that James is going to be teaching 30 years, all through those years, which is this. If our faith is real, listen now, if our faith is real, it will lead to action. Do you buy that? Now, and let me say this, not all the time. Nobody's arrived yet, folks. Nobody's arrived yet. You follow me around long enough, you're going to see, in reality, I'm not perfect. I don't do all those other things that everybody, you know, my illustration. And it won't be perfectly, but if it's the real thing, our lives show the effects of it. And there will be a godly, a general direction of godly living. You know, I've been a Christian for a few years. I didn't come from a Christian home. I grew up in a housing project. And I know how to do things. I remember how to do things. I remember words to say. I remember a totally different language. But I'm better than I was yesterday. I'm better than I was last year. And I'm a whole lot better than I was 40 years ago. And if you're really into that real faith, there is a general direction of godly living, doing the will of the Father type stuff. Right? And if not, it doesn't do any good for you. But it's also useless for others. Let's go back to that woman who's been coming into church. She stands there getting ready. Her kids are in a children's church or Sunday school or whatever you have. She's watching that person that claims to have faith kind of walk away, and she feels dumb for even bringing up, and she has this flush of embarrassment. She feels confused about what the Christian faith really is, and does it make any difference in people's lives, or is it just a bunch of smoke and mirrors? Is it just talk? And in embarrassment, she kind of lowers her head, and she sees her two kids running towards her, just little kids. Kind of like we see, I love this, when we see children. I love seeing children in church. I do. She sees them running towards her. And in addition to her car not working and her rent going up and having to work all kinds of hours, she's reminded that her two kids need new clothes, right? And as she walks out in the parking lot to a ride that somebody has given her to church, her embarrassment turns to anger, and she questions whether it's even worth coming back to church again, all because she had this interchange with somebody who claimed to have faith. And James says, if that's the kind of faith we have, what good is it? And for that single mom in that moment, his faith was useless. And you're thinking, whoa, hang on here. Wait just a minute. You mean I'm supposed to give money to everybody who asks for it? Seriously? Well, you could do that. You could do that. There are a lot of ways we can express our faith, right? There are a lot of ways we can do it. We can give her money, and sometimes that's good. Or we could say something like, you know, I don't know what provisions the church has for situations like that, but let me speak with the pastor. Let me speak with some leadership. Maybe we can find a way to ease your burden a little bit. Maybe we could, you know, hook you up with some other ladies in the church, and you could get to know each other, and they could help maybe take care of some needs, some family needs you've got. And you know, Bob over here, he's a pretty good mechanic. He's really, let me talk to Bob and see what he can do. And if he feels like he can fix it, we'll see if we can gin up a little money, you know, to help you get your car back going. You know, we could do something to help you. Or we could do something like this. Hey, Tim Rudd, he's loaded. Come on up, Tim, bring your wallet with you. We could do that. Or something. 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 Verse 16, it says, if one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, but does what? Nothing. It's useless. It does nothing for you. It does nothing for them. It's just good intentions and head knowledge. And that kind of faith is useless. Sometimes God brings us faith face to face with things like this. He does. You ever heard of A.W. Tozer? You ever heard of him? Great Christian Missionary Alliance pastor and evangelist. He said this. He said, we can prove our faith by our commitment to it and in no other way. Ooh. Any belief that does not command the one who holds it, it's not real belief. It's only pseudo belief, or what? Fake belief. Is it possible that in times like this, that God shows us through his word something that we need to honestly own? Something to do more. James gives us a vision and shows us what fake faith is like. Let me start wrapping this up with two examples of real faith. Here's real faith. Let me do this. The first one is verse 21. James brings this up. He says, was not our father Abraham considered righteous for what he did when he offered his son Isaac on the altar? This is found in Genesis chapter 2. You know the story. God tells Abraham to take his son to the top of this mountain and do what? Sacrifice him. Kill him, right? God is not known for doing that kind of stuff. Capping our kids. He's not. We can think of that on our own. Especially when they become teenagers, right? But all Abraham doesn't want to do this, but all he knows is that God's command is right there, and it's clear, and he can hear it. And he makes a decision, and he obeys God. He doesn't know that God is going to provide a sacrifice. He doesn't know this, but nevertheless, he takes his son up. I don't know if I could do that, very honestly. But Abraham acts on his faith. And James says that it was considered righteous for what he did. Now, here's a question. Don't answer it out loud again. Was it his obedience that made him right with God? I'll answer it. No, it wasn't his obedience. Because we're always saved by what? Faith. Faith. Whether it's the Old Testament or the New Testament. But it's the kind of faith, listen now, it's the kind of faith that shows up in the way we act. So his faith was proven or evidenced by what he did. Do this week, just a challenge, right? Coming up this week, let's call it an Abraham moment. Look for an Abraham moment in your life. So often, at times when we're challenged to Be sacrificial. That's what Abraham was doing. He was being sacrificial, wasn't he? So often when we're challenged to do something sacrificial, we find ourselves so often kind of backing off, you know, looking for an excuse to maybe do less, whether it's labor or resources, whatever, when it involves sacrifice. And maybe this week, keep your eyes open for those moments when God might be calling you to sacrifice something. When you're having an Abraham moment. Next time we see each other, maybe you'll come up and say, you know, funniest thing, just that following week I had an Abraham moment. I had to make a decision, but I made the right decision. Another picture here, verse 25. In the same way, it was not even Rahab the prostitute considered righteous for what she did when she gave lodging to the spies and sent them off in a different direction. This is from the book of Joshua, chapter 2. Here's the picture. The Israelites are getting ready to come into the promised land, so they send some spies in to check the place out. While they're in there, they're now in the city of Jericho. And the king of Jericho, he finds out some way that there are spies in the land. And they're real close to him in the city. So he sends out a couple of his goons to find these guys. And they're real close. And so they duck into this house, and it happens to be Rahab's house. And Rahab was a prostitute. She was a hooker, right? Now we read later on in the story that Rahab has become, listen now, a believer in the God of the Israelites, right? Remember that story? And so now these guys come knocking on. Open the door! We know the spies are in there. Let us in. She opens the door and says, they were here, but they're gone. Which way did they go? They went that way. And if you hurry, you might catch them. What they didn't know is they're up hiding on the roof. Remember that? She's hiding them on the roof. Was she taking a risk? Back in those days when everybody carried a sword, especially soldiers, she risked big time. She could have been taken prisoner, tortured, and killed very, very horrendously. But she didn't do it. By faith, she put herself at huge risk, and her faith compelled her to do it. Are there moments in your life, I know there are mine, when God is asking you to take a risk? Maybe it's your reputation. You know, maybe you're somewhere and you have an opportunity. Now, I'm not talking about pushing your way in the door. We don't have to do that because the Bible says nobody comes to the Father unless the Father what? Unless he calls or draws them. So if God's not calling that person, you can talk and yell and scream and preach all you want, but they're not coming. All you're doing is turning them off for that moment that God is going to speak to them. A lot of people never lead anybody to Christ because that person they're talking to can't get past them to see Jesus. They never reject Jesus. They just reject that messenger because they barge their way in. But maybe this week there will come an opportunity where you might plant a seed. I'm not talking about reaping a whole garden here. I'm just talking about planting a seed, just a word for the Father, a word for the Christ, the Messiah. You don't have to carry the whole load. Just plant the seed. And maybe if you do that, it'll blow your cover. Somebody will see. Are you religious? No, I'm not. But I am a believer in Jesus. I am a follower. I am a disciple of his. I'm not really religious. I just believe in Jesus. And doing that might risk your reputation. It might just do that. Maybe you'd have to risk failure. Maybe a reputation. Or in our country today, we might get to the place where we risk our safety. Ooh. Keep your eyes open for those, we'll call them those Rahab moments. Because God might be calling you to risk. Here's where I wrap it up. It seems like James is contradicting other parts of the Bible when he says these words. But in Matthew chapter 7, verse 16 through 20, Jesus says this, "By their fruit you will know them." Ooh. "Do people pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Likewise, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit." Then down in 20 it says, "So, by their fruit, you will know them." In other words, if our faith is real, it can't not produce faith in our lives, fruit in our lives. There will be integrity. There will be wholeness, undividedness. Nothing divided between what we do and what we say. Not perfectly, not all the time, because nobody's fully arrived, but where there is faith, there will be fruit. A few years ago, I read, there's the B-side right there. I read an interview with Michael Tate. Anybody know who Michael Tate is? Anybody? He used to be with a group called DC Talk. Remember that group? Okay. And they were doing an interview, and he just started talking about his father. I love this. Let me read a few lines. He said, "Let me tell you the two most important things I've learned from my dad. Number one, love people. That's what he taught. That's what he did. He cried with people. He laughed with people. Everybody was his friend. He could care less about your race, your nationality, your socioeconomic status. All he cared about was you, your soul. And number two, live for God. Don't get caught up in the things of this world because they're just fleeting. The world will get the best of you if you let it." And he said, "These two things have shaped who I am today. I love people. Life is short. God is real. And I need to live for him." Wouldn't every dad love to hear his kids say that? Wouldn't every dad love to make that kind of an impact on his children? Folks, we're living in a culture today where people are jaded, they're suspicious about faith because they've seen so much hypocrisy. So much hypocrisy. When they think about the Christian faith in their minds, it's just as ridiculous as a guy claiming to be a fitness fanatic and binging on Doritos, donuts, and cigars, right? Because that's all they've ever seen. And James reminds us that the thing that impacts people is integrity, where our words match up with our lives. Do you buy that? There's power in that kind of life, and it's only possible through the power of Christ. I love the bumper sticker that says, "Preach the gospel. Use words if you need to." Isn't that cool? Let's ask God for that kind of power. What do you say? Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for this message today. It's your message. Thank you for the words to deliver it. Thank you for that. Thank you for a receptive audience. Lord, I pray for that ability on a daily basis, that power to live a life that exemplifies Jesus. The Bible teaches us that Jesus and his disciples went about doing good. Lord, help us to be good doers. help us to practice what we preach so that people may see Jesus in us. We ask these things in your precious name. Amen. 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 Did you enjoy the Word of God?